Hi, welcome back to Cambridge Inside Out. I'm Judy Nathans.
And I'm Robert Winters.
Yeah, I'm going to continue. All right, so we've covered recycling, composting,
and
municipal broadband. Wow. Whew.
Yeah.
Okay,
all
so
right.
Let's go
What's
on
next?
To...
Well, I'll tell you what, let's just dispose of this, speaking of disposal.
Okay, but let's not spend a whole half hour.
No. Right. Let's dispose of this matter.
Yeah, Robert's become...
Yes.
Is a delegate.
I've been referring to myself as the reluctant delegate.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. The story was, and I probably mentioned this at a previous week, is that I went to a caucus meeting, a Democratic caucus meeting. I got elected as a delegate, my God.
To
biggest
the
surprise.
Democratic
State
Convention, which is next
Now, I am
weekend.
Not a party animal. I don't really care that much about the political parties.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I was elected as a delegate, so I'm going to make the most of it and try and figure out what the Democratic Party is really about these days, so I'm going to go. But the funny thing is, I don't know funny, it's actually kind of an annoying thing about becoming a delegate, especially if you're not already known to be committed to candidate A or candidate
B,
is that you start getting things in the mail and you start getting phone calls from candidates. I've had at least one gubernatorial candidate just call me at home trying to get my vote,
lobbying
right?
You, yeah.
You know, I mean, honestly, it's actually time well spent to just to lobby some delegates
as opposed
be there.
To yeah.
broadcast.
But what
politics.
Actually is your role there, and what do you actually, what's your vote
you
going
to
do?
I'm kind of new at this, and they are saying you're supposed to. Oh, they're recommending you do the training. I don't think I'm going to bother with that.
I thought you've been a delegate in the past.
No.
Oh my goodness, you're not doing the training.
I will say that I'm going there with one thought in mind, which is that I would like to know what the Democratic Party actually really is these days, because the piece that I see locally, I see sort of like these Sanders type of people who are trying to revolutionize and take things over. But then I've known a lot of people who are what we used to call lunch bucket Democrats, just regular old working stiffs and, you know, just wanted a fair shake
for
working
guy. Mike Capuano is kind of...
Yeah, so Mike Capuano is to me more of a lunch bucket old-time Democrat.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, the revolutionary kind of people, they're, you know, they've got a very pretty strong...
Yeah.
I'll be kind and say leftist agenda. But it's actually a little
well,
stronger
Bernie's
than
still
that.
Considering maybe running in 2020.
Yeah, well, we'll see.
Yeah.
So I'm going to go. But anyway, it's like my mailbox is full. So I get like the Secretary
Jeez.
Galvin, who's got a challenger, who is this
right.
fellow named Josh.
This is all
Josh
to determine
Zakim.
The primary
it's basically,
that will be nominated.
It's,
to
yeah. It's so I got here. There's two from Bill Galvin.
This is the first time he's had a serious challenger,
right? long time. I don't think there's a lot to decide at these things. You know, it might be otherwise in a different
more
year.
More to show the support for whoever you're.
I think you have to get 15% of the vote at a convention
to
get
on
the primary ballot.
Oh, okay.
So if you had five candidates, they might not all get the necessary 15%.
Right.
So they might not all be on the primary, and then that's it for them, unless they want to run as an independent, right? So for the most part, if there are any challengers at all for the statewide seats, there's now just two. I mean, for governor, there were three. It was
right.
Bob Massey, Cindy Warren, and Jay Gonzalez,
and then Cindy Warren
yanked out.
Dropped out. Mm-hmm.
So now it's just two, and as far as I'm concerned, they're both pretty much guaranteed to get 15% support.
Yeah.
So there's really nothing to decide other than to go through the formality of a vote for them.
What about Lieutenant Governor?
Lieutenant Governor, it's a
other
guy
than
named
Jimmy Tingle. Is there anyone else?
There's also a guy named Quentin Palfrey, who is running for a lieutenant governor. I'm with Tingle. I guess it's sounding like a delegate, right? I'm sorry, sir, but I'm with Tingle.
But he's pretty progressive.
Oh,
maybe.
He's very qualified. Yeah. But the thing is that Jimmy grew up the street from me. And,
sure.
You know,
No. I'm trying to think if he's part
being.
Of the whatever.
You know, the thing is, you could sort of see who they're trying to appeal to. You know, you can actually see... in their, like, for example, Bill Galvin, who's sort of more of an old school Democrat,
right.
from my
mm-hmm.
view, you know, because of these sort of Bernie type people who are all going to take on Wall Street.
Yeah.
So he comes out with got to put it in here in the camera, right?
Yeah.
You know, a picture of the bull on Wall Street saying,
oh.
Secretary Galvin, grab the bull by its horns.
That is a bad optic. You know why? Because that was challenged by the fearless girl who was on
the
other side.
Yeah.
Oh, bad move.
I know.
Feminists aren't going to like that.
I know.
Oh, but
he's
got Elizabeth Warren on there.
On the back, too.
Right.
You know, so I look at that and I say, he's making sure that the Bernie people don't overthrow him. Right? because, yeah. you know, Wall Street, Elizabeth Warren, yeah.
Are Bernie people way big behind Josh Zeka?
I don't know, but, you know, he's trying to, you know, he's younger, and a lot of the Bernie people are younger, you know.
Okay.
But, yeah, so anyway, it'll be interesting.
Yeah.
I'm gonna do a little bit of homework.
So when they said training, what would be the training? You have to go somewhere else?
Well, I'm not going to do any of their training. You know what I'm going to do?
What?
I'm going to read All Politics is Local by Tip O'Neill.
Oh, gosh.
And one of my all-time favorite books is Hardball, How Politics is Played by, as told by one who knows the game.
Wait.
This is Chris Matthews before the TV show Hardball. He wrote a book called Hardball.
Right. Well, he also worked in the White House, didn't he?
He worked for Tip O'Neill.
Okay.
He was Tip O'Neill. So I'm going to learn some old school politics.
Good for you.
And actually, a good friend of mine who works at City Hall gave me this.
Oh my goodness.
Gave me this recording of Tip O'Neill's favorite Boston Irish stories and tunes.
Oh my gosh! So look at that.
See, I'm doing my homework.
You are. I'll have to borrow that someday and burn it to my computer, okay?
Right.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Anyway, so that's coming up this weekend. It's Friday into Saturday, and, you know, I'm not sure
because
I haven't worked anything out. Part of the reason for taking
it's
my VW
bus. It's only in Worcester, right?
It's only in Worcester. So I took my VW bus
into
the
mechanic. Will that
be ready? Well, it should be. But part of the reason I did it is that I want to make sure it was, if I have the option of actually driving out and living in my bus.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, anyway, we'll see. I have a friend who lives out there. Maybe I could stay there. I don't know. But I have to make some phone calls.
There's also Airbnb, but you don't have a phone. You can't use an app. You have an iPad. Wait a minute.
What? How do you use this thing?
Wait, you have an iPad, but you have to have Wi-Fi, right, to use your iPad?
Yeah, and I don't have Wi-Fi.
What do you mean you don't have Wi-Fi?
Oh, no, actually,
you could buy a plan. I know people did that where you can get a certain amount of data on your iPad.
Yeah?
Yeah. Right. You didn't know that?
I thought I might just bring some string and some tin cans.
Okay. All right. Whatever. So, sleep in your van.
Yeah. All right. But the thing is that, you know, they may have real problems in Worcester because they have a lot of conventions out there, and they go, we don't want any people sleeping in your car.
Well, no, you get the friend that you know, and if you can't stay, you just stay in the driveway.
Yeah, or find some campground or something.
Yeah, or you go to
just like the good old days.
Motel 6, I don't know.
Yeah, no, it's,
you
know.
You could spend some money.
Yeah, I could do that too. Yeah that's right. Not going to break me.
No.
So anyway, so that's something that's coming up. We did mention about the Envision Cambridge.
Right, because there was an advisory meeting
the overall
at the Senior
advisory
Center
committee.
Last Wednesday.
Yeah,
and you're on that.
I'm on that.
And I went to the women's panel at the library, so why don't you talk about what
happened? Yeah, you know, it's all sort of starting to blend.
How many people were there, by the way?
Mm-hmm. There weren't very many people in the audience.
There were a lot of things going on.
And a lot of times when you look at the people in the audience, you go, well, I think that person's actually a staff person for somebody, so they're not really like a general member of the general public.
Yeah.
It was reasonably well attended. I think, I forget exactly how many people were there, maybe about 12 to 15 members of the committee, which is
But what about other
staff.
Committees? So that's it?
The working groups weren't really there. But
so the audience was not really...
Well, some of the members, the way they've done this, and I think it's actually a good idea, is there are some people who serve on the advisory committee, two people for each of the working groups came from the advisory committee.
I see.
So that's how I came to be on the housing working group.
Okay.
But there are other people who are on the mobility group, and then there's the environment and
climate. And they were there,
one.
So everybody was represented.
Yeah, one person I know who's actually, she's the person from the advisory committee who's on the climate and environment working group, feels they're not being bold enough.
Huh.
Because I'm on the housing group, and I kind of feel that it's kind of degenerating. Well, I'm being overly judgmental in saying that, but it's largely become kind of a lobbying effort for more regulated housing. And housing is a little bit more general than just the regulated housing. But
yes.
So I think that needs a little work. But you know, I don't know what the mobility group is going to come out. Whether it's, you know, hopefully it's not going to be all bike lanes and nothing else.
So what was the agenda of this meeting?
This was the general advisory committee. Actually, they wanted us to review some particular things.
Okay.
Different scenarios for densities and heights around the city. You know, there seems to be kind of a presumption, and I think some people might not be happy about it, but a presumption that in fact additional density and more development around the city is a foregone conclusion. Now, I kind of felt that when this whole process started that they would have ultimately come to that conclusion because...
Well, it's already happening.
Well, they threw some numbers.
Go to Alewife. I mean, goodness.
Well, what they're saying is that just based on current zoning and just what projects that are in the pipeline and whatever, is that they were expecting there to be, you know, 40,000 new jobs total.
New jobs or units?
In another 20 years, right?
Oh.
And with those jobs, those would not be, pushing a broom jobs. Those would be typically high-tech jobs.
Jobs in Cambridge?
Yeah, it seems like a pretty high number.
Or in the greater Boston area.
I mean, we already have more jobs than we have people in Cambridge.
Yeah, I
so, but the thing is, every building that goes up that's not housing in Kendall Square represents a bunch of people who work there.
Yeah.
And, you know, so you build a few buildings that are commercial and you get a lot of jobs. And and those people who will take those jobs will then want to live somewhere. And the current social norm seems to be that people do appreciate living close to where they work.
But aren't those buildings also going up in Kendall Square?
So they're building some housing as well. But the thing is that, so how much housing do you have to build just to support the growth in the jobs from the other buildings?
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want to necessarily kill the goose and the golden egg by cutting off the jobs.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, well, there's also some constitutional reasons why you can't just do that.
Mm.
But so they were anticipating somewhere close to 13,000 new housing units. You know, and, you know, a 24% increase in housing to match a 32% growth in employees.
Okay, but when they say housing, do they mean for single professionals? Do they mean family housing? There's a big difference here.
The thing is that one of the things that I think some of the members of the committee were dissatisfied with was that there wasn't enough fine-grained discussion
about
of things like
what
that.
Is how, right.
What do you mean by housing? Because
you can build a unit, but they're building units. Look at Alewife area. I mean, those are all one or two bedroom places. And
exactly, but the people who are building the housing are saying, well, we're building that because not because we feel like it, but because we see
that's
the market.
That's what the need is. Exactly.
You know,
if the
demand says that's what people want, then that's what you build. So mandating a certain number of three bedroom units so that families can have.
Well, that's where you get the inclusionary zoning part of it in there.
That's
a
part of the revised inclusionary zoning.
Some of this stuff has happened with. Yeah.
Right, but every new building, new housing of 10 units or greater is subject to inclusionary zoning. So, and there are some rules about including larger units for families. You know, I think this is a lot of detail that needs still to be worked out. And honestly, since this Envision Cambridge process, is set to finish up around November, December year. I'm now looking at going, is this really going to happen, or are we just going to make a quick report and run?
Well, there has been a sort of draft report already. Didn't they present a while? In fact, there's going to be a roundtable on Envision coming
up. Yes, I think
so. That's going to be probably some of this
stuff.
What is it?
It's like June 11th or something like that.
Okay, it's a Tuesday. I think it's June.
Yeah, I think what I'm going to
June 11th.
Right, so my guess is that because the timing is starting to get tight.
Yeah.
Really is. We'll be in June. They say, you know, within half a year they're going to be done. And a half a year goes by like a blink of an eye in Cambridge.
Well, half a year would be beyond November from June.
Right. So,
oh, you're talking about from when
Done. So I suspect that the counselors will probably be very point blank direct about some things, which has not been the case up to this point. Because they say, well, what is the work product? Where are we going to go with this? How much of this is complete? What's been decided?
Right.
What will be our job as city councilors to decide? Are you actually going to give us just loosey-goosey ideas? Mm-hmm. Or are you giving us hard zoning recommendations?
Right.
And how debatable are they? I think there's a lot to be argued here. You know, one of the things that I speculated when we first started, before they called it Envision Cambridge, when it was just the master plan process was that when all is said and done, the recommendations, just based on a lot of hashing things out with a good expertise and the best intentions, might actually make recommendations that some of the political people and the advocates will not like more density, for example.
So
that'll be an interesting day when we have to have that argument, because it's been coming for a while.
And also, all with this, there is talk about, and Denise has brought this up, and Dennis Carlone, schools. You have to build another school. We've closed schools, but what's going to happen down in East Cambridge where you're building, a lot of that stuff hasn't happened yet. Where
right.
And Alewife, too. I mean,
yeah.
Although they are, I think they're Tobin's up for a redo.
Yeah, you know, at the end of the meeting last week, I was pretty vocal at this meeting. But
yeah.
I was being half facetious. But I said maybe rather than try and look at the city as a whole and saying we should be increasing density by such and such percentage, is that we should really think about much more fine-grained view of each of the squares and major corridors. So, for example, we like to think of Central Square as the cultural district.
Mm-hmm.
So the zoning should reflect it, you know, whether it's through an arts overlay or whatever,
mm-hmm.
to encourage people who are going to own property, buy property, build property here, to try and respect the theme that is associated with that square, right? And, you know, so you might decide that Harvard Square is something or Porter Square is something else. And somebody said, well, what would you call it, Alewife? And I called it the motel zone because it's been my personal point of view that most of the housing that's been popping up there, which it's not motels.
It's rentals, though.
No, but the thing is that it's, I would be interested to hear how long people stay
there. Oh, yeah, it's
there.
More transient. There's something called the Vox. Do you know about them? Because that's the one, if you go out on Route 2, and I don't even know if that's Cambridge still, is that Arlington? There's that, you know where the Faces and Places used to be? That whole area there?
That was Cambridge Research Park.
Cambridge
Science Park.
Yeah, but
Cambridge
I'm
Research
talking
Park
about
was the
right
old Com
before
Energy
you get there, there was a bowling alley. I don't know if that's still there.
Lanes
Faces
and Games.
And Places.
Lanes and Games,
that
Faces.
That whole area, there's now a big complex, and it's called Vox.
Yeah.
And I think those are rentals.
Yeah.
But I'm not
yeah.
sure that's Cambridge right there.
Right. But the thing is
and behind there, there's all kinds of
but
buildings.
But, you know, 20 years from now, is there going to be some old Kaja coming out of Vox saying, I've been living up here in this neighborhood for 20 years?
Of course not. It's all for people using the red line to go into jobs. And
I suspect it's when
those are the jobs that...
Right, but so and I'm not saying there's not a need for a district like that, but basically it strikes me as a, you know, you move into a place like that because you need a place.
Yeah,
and then
especially
you got a job, and then as soon as you move in, you're already looking for where you're going to move eventually.
Right, but then
city
needs places like, no, it's not, but is that right there a neighborhood anyway? Come on, right?
No,
on
it's
Route
not.
2?
No, it's not. That's why I call it the motel zone. Right.
But the tall buildings that are off that road that you can only go one way in, one way out, that's scary to me. I don't like the way that looks.
Oh, the Cambridge Park Drive.
Yes.
Right, but the thing is, you do have that kind of man-made wetland area. There actually are some interesting attractions.
Yeah.
But you are kind of isolated from the rest of the city. So
there's the mall on the right you can get to, but and
it doesn't,
Summer Shack. But it's not neighborhood. I would never call that area a neighborhood.
Neither would I, but you know, but wouldn't it be nice if every place
people
could be?
You've got you've got tracks behind, you've got the whole quadrangle thing. It's just,
hey, listen, people.
It can be changed, though.
It can be changed.
We have a chance to do it in the quadrangle.
Yeah, I just think every place should have something that can help to define it. You know.
Right. Well, what helps define that is I think it's near the red line and it's got I don't know.
Yeah, but it's not all. It can't all just be utilitarian. Like, well, I'm living here because the commuting is easy.
No, but then you move to a place that does provide that.
Right. So I made one of my little rants was I said, you know, to me, I want to know, you know, it doesn't matter whether you've got a building that's 6 stories tall or 16 stories or 60 stories tall. The thing is just tell me that if you're somebody who's 16-year-olds living there, can you find a place to hang out, right? If you're a mother with children, can you have places where you can sort of do things together?
It's not going to be there.
Maybe not there.
Even with inclusionary zoning, you're not going to have enough of
it. But we're not just talking about that zone. I mean, let's...
But in general. No, Dennis Carlone thinks these things.
No, I agree.
Yeah,
I agree.
Yeah.
He should be very, very helpful in this discussion.
Yeah.
When we talk about what will Porter Square be in the future, some people may not want to hear it, but the recommendation seems to be that a place like Porter Square is underbuilt. It's got red line and commuter rail right there, so why aren't there, you know, 30-story buildings in Porter Square?
Oh, so in other words, because there have been a lot of buildings there and a lot of apartment complexes, but they're usually 4 stories.
But this will be quite a battle, right? Some people would argue Harvard Square should have much more significant buildings than they have now.
But I think that's already a given in some of those areas. Because first of all, there's not as much residential.
But there's a lot of pushback from people.
Yeah.
So, you know, so.
But
we'll,
they're allow, aren't they zoning allow higher height?
Well,
yet?
The Crone petition wanted to allow some additional height, but in fact, they made it so that it would have to be only residential, but then that went against the Gerald Chan property.
But I'm saying the existing zoning now allows for how much height in Hollywood Square?
It depends where, but I'm not sure.
I mean, look at the Holyoke Center. That's pretty high.
But that's also university, and there are certain exemptions that they can enjoy.
Okay.
Now,
right.
Where Felipe's is,
yeah.
Around there, there's some clearly underbuilt.
Right,
that's got to go
like,
up, ultimately.
Right,
you know,
yeah.
Eventually. So it's not a matter of, do you want to make it go up?
I know.
It's going up.
Yeah.
Maybe not this year, maybe not 10 years from now, but eventually these things will happen.
I like
so
things
how do you
not,
shape it?
Not above 8, but that's me.
No, that my personal preference is that I don't want to be living in high rises, but you know, but I don't mind having high rises around.
It depends on what, because but I do know when I go out on Route 2. Do you go out and see that?
No,
Cambridge
I don't.
Park Drive, you know, those buildings.
I've seen them. I go
like
walk
20,
through them.
20 stories, aren't they? No,
yeah.
Maybe not that high.
Yeah, no, I don't think they're that high.
10 stories.
But
yeah.
But it's again what I said at this meeting was I don't care if it's 16 or 60 stories. Just tell me what it's like when you're there. Just tell me what the experience is.
Well, go to Kendall Square. Go to Seaport if you want to see what it's like.
Right.
There's big complaints about that.
Right.
They do have tall buildings.
But I have good friends living down Lower East Side in Manhattan, you know, and they've got some tall buildings and
but
some.
That's Manhattan. Manhattan's had tall buildings for years.
Right. But my point is that these are really great neighborhoods.
True.
So you can have great neighborhoods with tall buildings, and you can have really crummy neighborhoods with low buildings, you know, so that the discussion shouldn't just be about height and density, you know, and it also shouldn't just be about somehow solving some societal problems. So saying, you know, because people there's insufficient housing in the region, therefore Cambridge has to house everybody.
No, the region's
got to do
anything,
this.
Right,
you know?
Which is also, so you got to look at that, because that's what Sean Turney would talk about.
Yeah,
that. It's got to be a regional solution.
Right, but you know, don't do it out of some sense of guilt. Do it because you're creating a great place. And we can, you can have dense, great places, but they have to be great places.
Yeah,
I mean,
but,
I think,
you know, but again, the New York and maybe the people you know, how long have they been there? Because I think that the old New York, you did have community, but now it's so expensive to live in some of these places that you don't have the community.
I'm not a fan of rent control, but in fact,
that's why they could live there, but they don't have that.
A lot of those people.
But they don't have that anymore.
Well, the thing is as people get older and vacancy decontrol
happens, it'll
all disappear.
It's going away.
Right.
And it's not just New York and here, it's everywhere.
But anyway, I'm getting a little worried that we've got 6 months left in Envision Cambridge, and I think there's a long way to go.
That's
going to
be a very interesting roundtable, and I would suggest all of you that will be televised.
June
11th.
I love the staff people from UTIL and the people within the Community Development Department who are working hard on this, but I think this is the time now. The councilors have to get kind of play some hardball.
Yeah, well, I'm sure they are.
And they have to kind of show their cards a little bit. They can't, they shouldn't, I don't want to see a situation where the counselors are kind of just sitting back and waiting for Community Development Department to stick their necks out and saying this is what we think is right.
Yeah.
And then so the counselors can go just shoot them like a duck gallery.
I think they're working behind the scenes.
I don't know. I haven't seen a lot of presence.
Well, what about all these petitions that people keep coming up with?
There's exactly one zoning petition before the city right now, and that's the Brown Nakagawa one, which came out of some of the Alewife working group. They pretty much sort of jumped the gun.
Is that the one that the climate?
Well, they've rolled that into it as well, which wasn't really there. I mean, there's a lot of discussion we could have about what's really going on
with that one. But is that still in process, is I guess I'm asking?
No, it hasn't even had its ordinance committee or its planning board committee planning board hearing.
So where is it at?
It's in June.
It's got to get a recommendation from the...
June 27th, 5:30 p.m., City Council's Ordinance Committee will conduct a public hearing to discuss the zoning petition received from Douglas Brown et al. To amend the zoning and blah, 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 blah. Now, I think I've said in an earlier version of this program that I think there are two petitions lurking within that petition. One has to do with a citywide, I would call it more like a citywide overlay that basically says these are the sort of environmental standards we're doing because we're really gung-ho about climate change.
Right.
And then there's
that area, yeah.
Alewife.
Right.
And they really, these should not be joined in a single petition. And the councillors, if they have any wits about them, would split it into two.
Okay.
And deal with them individually, you know? So so that's a comment. You know, it's actually a rare time in the last 20 years to actually have so few zoning petitions in the pipeline. Mm. Maybe part of the reason is because of Envision Cambridge.
Yeah.
Maybe everybody's waiting, and then Envision will say, do this, and then
and then
citizen's petition will say, no, do that.
Sure.
I don't know how this is going to play out, but, you know, right now this is kind of, I think this may be the calm before the storm.
Right.
And then you'll start seeing very specific recommendations. They will probably be denser and higher than most people are used to. But even though, you know, but they're basically making the point that people are coming. You know, you can't just wish them away.
Yep.
And unless you want to make the city a crime zone, in which case people go, I don't want to live in Cambridge. That's a pit. But that ain't going to happen, right? So so you just kind of have to accept the fact that people do want to live here.
Yep.
You know, it's the price you pay for making a city a pretty good place, right? People want to live there.
And it's expensive.
Yeah,
and
it's expensive.
Expensive,
right?
But it's not just here. Anywhere that's desirable. D.C., Seattle,
and
New York.
Again, my little
San
sore
Francisco.
Spot is you're not solving the affordability problem simply by setting aside regulated units for those people who want to get a house that way, because there's going to be a lot of people who are kind of in the middle who just are looking for a house.
Right, but...
And who knows how they get handled, you know?
It's unfortunate.
Yeah, oh yeah, yeah. So anyway, it'll be interesting.
Yes.
So stay tuned for that
and
in
there's
June.
Lots of committee meetings in June. Go to Robert's Civic Calendar, because I think everyone, because the last... City Council meeting is the end of June, right?
That's
June
right.
June 18th or June.
Actually, a very quick one in the last 20 seconds. For those of you who are really hot to trot about the Harvard Square kiosk, the working group meeting for that is this Thursday at 6:45 in the Acker Room at City Hall. So if you care about that, show up.
Kiosk,
you know,
okay.
Be a citizen.
All
right. Anyway, see you in a couple weeks on good old Cambridge Inside Out.